fertile ground, that when your word is spoken, that it may be buried deep within good soil and bear much fruit for your kingdom. So God, at this time we pray for our service. Lord, we pray for our church, Lord Jesus. We pray for Moksaim and Samonim as they head to Korea today. Lord, we pray for your healing hand to be upon them, that you may watch over them and protect them, Lord Jesus. So we thank you for this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's all rise. Let's spend some time greeting each other warmly in the Lord. Look around. Say hello. Hi, how are you? You know, it's good to see Austin and Kijung back from Berkeley. Justin's up here temporarily before he heads back down to SD. Yeah, and like I said, a lot of our members are traveling. Even though our worker, a lot of our young adults are traveling right now too. So, but you know, it's great to see everyone, and let's begin worship and praise the Lord with all of our hearts.
So 주님
곳에서 드리는 예배를 받으소서. 주님의 이름이 주님의 이름만이 오직 주의 이름만 이곳에 있습니다.
There may be pain in the night. I know that you love me.
Say one more time, you stay the same.
Your love never fails.
You stay the same through the ages.
Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid. I know that you love me. Your love never fails.
Let's give a clap offering to the Lord.
To my soul.
Restoration to my soul.
Here I am waiting. Abide in me, I pray. Here I am longing for you, Jesus. Hide me in your love. Bring me to my knees. May I know Jesus more and more. Come live in me all my life. Take over. Come breathe in me. I will. Make this our prayer. Here I am waiting.
Here I am waiting. Abide in me, I pray. Here I am longing for you.
Your hearts, let's make this a determination today. Come live in me.
Come live in me all my life. Take over. Come breathe in me. I will.
This time Brother Charles will come out and pray for us.
Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for this time as we just gathered together for this Sunday, Father. I'll just have an opportunity just to worship you and to glorify you, Father. Many of us have recently finished our school, that have come back for home, Father, or some of us are still continuing their education, Father, while others are currently working, Father. Father, really pray that for those who have come back from their college, really pray that you use this summer just to recharge and to find true rest in you, Father. Father, also pray that we may find true identity in you, Father, not by the world, Father. Father, also as there are so many things that are going on in our lives, whether it be pleasant or unpleasant, regardless of hardships, Father, really pray that none of these things come hold back from us worshiping you fully, Father. Father, also lift up for Boksani Samoni as they're leaving for Korea tonight for their sabbatical month, Father, that they'll find a rest in you as they go to Korea and come as they recharge and use this month just to come just to glorify you, Father, and come back even with more energy, more spirit from you, Father, to serve us, Father. Father, also lift up for Teacher Sam as he comes and gives his message, Father. Really pray that you will use his tongue just to inspire us and remind us to have you in our center, Father. Not us in the center, but have you in our life, Father, to remind us how there's nothing we can do without you, Father, but with your power, your spirit, that we can overcome hardships, Father. Just thank you so much for this precious Sunday. We pray in the Son's name. Amen.
And you may be seated. All right. Once again, welcome. For announcements, Brother Charles just prayed, my parents, they'll be heading out to Korea tonight, and they'll be gone for a month on sabbatical. We call it a sabbatical. It's the second sabbatical my parents have ever been on in 30 plus years of ministry, but it's not really a sabbatical. It's a month, and if you guys were here for first and second worship and you saw the announcement, my dad will be speaking, I think, every Sunday all around Korea, and some night revivals as well. So please keep them in your prayer. They are going to serve our family in Korea. So if you can just pray for their health. Both of my parents have been struggling with health. My dad's recovering from his prostate cancer. My mom, you guys know, she had osteomyelitis infection in her bone in her finger, and she's getting over that. So if you guys can just really pray that it will be a time of rest amidst everything they have to do there. So that is one announcement. For today, as you guys know, a lot of our members aren't here, so we were planning to have small group. We will continue with it, but two of our small group leaders are not here today. So Jake Gunsanim was supposed to lead one of the groups, but he's not here today because Onyu, just the last 3 days, he's just had a really high fever. And he's been vomiting, and he's not feeling well. So if you guys could pray for Onyu, it would be much appreciated. So Sun Yun and I came, and she served, and they're kind of doing a tag team type of thing. But if you guys can keep them in your prayer, and keep Jake Gansanim, especially Onyu, in your prayer, would be much appreciated. So I think what we've decided to do today is, after worship, we will split up into our small groups. We will all share at church. And then after small groups are done, we're all going to head somewhere together to have fellowship. So I will be in charge of Josh's small group. Josh is coming back on Tuesday. He's in Hawaii right now because his mom is here, a missionary in India. And Josh's grandma, on his mom's side, lives in Hawaii. So they're there right now serving their grandma. Also, he's trying to evangelize to some of his family members there as well. So please keep Josh in your prayer. Chris is also traveling, so he's not here today, but Mike will be leading that small group today. And also, on an announcement for Brother Josh, he is going to start seminary this fall. And starting from this week, he's actually going to start serving church. So that's really exciting news for the church when it comes to activities and events for our third worship. We're planning a lot this summer, and with him there, it'd be a lot easier to push things through. We are planning a retreat and all that good stuff. Remember, next week, for those of you who do not know, my uncle's opening his house to anyone who wants to come. It's Minji's farewell party. My uncle really wanted to have it at his house, so Minji's having a farewell party at my uncle's place, 4 o'clock. I think he's making hamburgers. Afterwards, we're going to do stuff, but that's a surprise, because we want to keep the activity kind of secret, because we don't want Minji to know, and she's here. I mean, she knew we were going to do something after, so that's not a surprise, but the activity in of itself will be. Next week will be probably either a small group or a break week. I'll talk with the small group leaders. We haven't had a small group in a while, and you know, a lot of our members aren't here, so I think having two small groups in a row would be nice. Last announcement is, sorry, like Praise Team knows, I was kind of all over the place when we were practicing, because a missionary from Peru is here right now. And for those of you who know, once in 2 years, our church goes on summer missions for 2 weeks. And last time we went to Costa Rica, the year before Nicaragua. And for a long time, we've been praying and asking God, you know, God, where should we go next? Where can we? We've been looking for a place where we can partner with long term, maybe 5 to 10 years, where we can go and partner together with them and serve the people there and help set up Sunday school systems, VBS, so on and so forth. Through Kenny, actually, Kenny's going to actually S City. I think I could say it up here, right? He's going to Shanghai with KCCC NYU in like a week. And he serves KCCC under like the staff there. And one of the staff members is actually one of my friends from Talbot, Chi. And you know, she's going too. So Kenny informed me that she was going on missions as well. So I texted her, and then she's like, hey, you want to help sponsor me? I'm like, of course. And she's like, what, are you guys going to mission? I'm like, yeah, we're going next year, but we're still praying for a place. She's like, you want to go to Peru? And I'm like, sounds good. So she's like, my friend's dad is a missionary there, and she was also raised in South America. So she gave me the missionary's first son's information, same age as her. He was UCLA Tepio when she was UCI Tepio. And, you know, so like, you know, small world, right? So we met him yesterday, and then he's like, hey, you know what? My dad's actually coming tonight. So his dad came to our church, 11 o'clock worship, and he's talking with Pastor Sung and my dad right now. And small world is, I even know the missionary's youngest son, because I went to school with him at Talbot. And we were in the same basketball team for intramurals. So it's such a small world. And like, you know, we were just sharing our ministry, they were sharing their ministry, and it seems like a very good match. So we're really excited. So at the end of this year, we are going to go on a week tapsa. And if as we pray and we seek God's guidance, as we talk to the missionary, if God opens the door, next year, next summer missions will be to Peru. But it's looking more and more likely by the day. So please continue to pray for that. And you know, if you start praying if you want to go. It's 2 weeks in the summer, probably June or July. Start preparing now. For those of you who work, you know, if you're interested in going, see if you can open up those 2 weeks. We'll be getting the date out to everyone shortly. But I think that's it for announcements. On that note, you know, it's good to see Justin, Austin, and Kijong here. You know, I know D-Choi is here. He was here last week, but this will be his last week. He's heading back to Boston for a paid and free housing internship in Boston. He'll be doing, was it number crunching? Yeah, he'll be doing number crunching, but good for him. And, you know, Austin's only here for this week, but he's heading back to Berkeley for a paid internship as well. And the Kijong will be staying here until Charles graduates and will be heading back, I believe, for research. Yeah. So on that note, let's all stand up. Let's go around. Let's greet each other warmly in the Lord. And today, Teacher Sam will come up and give the word of the Lord today.
I see a lot of people yawning. Is it because of me or is it just that time after lunch? You know, they say you lose sleep as you get older. That's not true. I'm very sleepy as is. I think I sleep about 4 to 5 hours a day because I commute pretty early. And, you know, I thought when I get older, I'm 46 now. I thought when I'm around mid-40s, approaching 50s, I thought I would be like coming to 새벽기도 and stuff. No, it's still very tough. I don't want to say I'm young in heart. That's a lie. I'm very old from my 20s. I think I had the same heart. So I'm finally catching up to my age in appearance and my heart and everything else. So I see some of you yawning. I understand. We'll try to make it through today's message. I thought it was pretty personal for me. You know, last time I spoke about forgiveness, only because I'm not good at forgiving. And in my pursuit of finding out what's the best way, what does the Bible say? How do I actually realistically do it instead of forgive and forget, which is commonly thrown around like cliche? Today I want to talk about jealousy. There's a jealousy that we think of, and then there's a jealousy that Bible mentions that God is a jealous God. It's one of those hard things to tackle because I'm not really good with the topic, and I wanted to actually see why God calls himself a jealous God. For what, right? So how many of you here have never been jealous? Raise your hand. Never been jealous. Honest to God. Don't lie in church. I've never been jealous. Raise your hand. Okay. So I've been jealous at least once in my lifetime. Raise your hand. Some of you are not raising your hand. Okay, everyone, right? Okay, so jealous is common. 다 질투를 조금씩 해요. Why do you get jealous? My daughter, she's 10. She's fourth grade. And she was speaking to my wife about her friends. And, oh, she got so jelly. Like, what is jelly? I guess she was talking about jealous. Little kids even, right? They're jelly over something. Oh, so jealousy is not really uncommon, no matter what your age is. You know, like little babies, they get jealous too, right? And it's like raw. They come out at you and they like scratch other babies like when they get more, right? It doesn't change when you're 80 or 90 years old too. The older they get, it becomes even more gross and nasty because you know how to manipulate. That's not the jealousy that God is talking about. But I think there's a reason why God calls himself jealous for us. There's a difference between jealous of something versus jealous for something. And I think that's the main difference too. Exodus 25 is the verse that I picked as our scripture today. You shall not bow down or worship the idols, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. That's one of the Ten Commandments. It comes out not to worship idols. And then God mentions it in the same breath, Exodus 20, verse 5. When we think about jealousy, forgive me for not having Pretzi. I didn't have time. My wife dropped her phone yesterday, and that's like a third screen that's cracked. And we almost lost all the pictures inside. I think she had like 5,000 pictures from 2 years of kids' pictures. Not my pictures, but kids' pictures. So she was devastated. So I was staying out until like 6, 7 p.m. waiting to get this fixed. Apple Genius Bar certainly told us to look at the website, what a genius they are. So we had to go to an aftermarket place and they've restored it. So there it goes. Apple 0, aftermarket 1. So I had to stay out till pretty late, and I think I couldn't quite get Pretzi in place. So the punishment is that I have to look at myself on the screen. So when you think about the jealousy part, we think of King Saul. King Saul was jealous of his son-in-law, David, and it drove him nuts till the end of his life, right? I think part of his that is related to his jealousy over David. He couldn't quite manage anything else but because she was so overwhelmed with jealousy. Now, was King Saul the Queen Saul? No. I think we tend to think, maybe my generation, I don't know about your generation, to think that jealousy is a women thing. You haven't seen guys getting jealous. Getting jealous in ministry, have you seen that? One pastor knocking down another pastor in the ministry, and so on, and so on, and so on. In the Bible studies too, who's the teacher's pet, right? Someone always raises a right hand, and they always know the correct Bible verse. And people get jealous. So yuchihae. So like preschool stuff. Doesn't matter what your age is. But that's human jealousy. Right? So it makes it even more weird that God is saying, I'm a jealous God. I'm a jealous God. There's one philosopher, a French philosopher, said there's four pains that come with human jealousy. One of them is that the jealousy itself is very painful for you. Was it painful for you? I think when you are like overwhelmed with jealousy, right? Charles is nodding back there, you know? He knows. It really hurts you inside, right? It makes you nuts. Like all the Korean drama, there's always jealousy somewhere. That's why I always create like love triangle. Someone's jealous over something, and there's a good guy, there's a bad guy. Women always falls for the bad guy, and it doesn't work out. And the good guy is over, you know, things like that. So jealousy is a very powerful emotion, and it really hurts. There are some sisters and brothers that I see that when their love is not realized, or they love somebody, their crush doesn't work out, they either leave or they turn really angry. Second pain is that you blame yourself for being jealous. Right? You blame yourself. So it becomes very self-destructive. Third thing is that your jealousy hurts the other person that you're supposed to be loving. It hurts your wife. It hurts your kids. It hurts your friends. It hurts your mom and dad. It hurts your pastors. It hurts your leaders. It really hurts. It really cuts away. You say mean things just like out of emotion. Fourth thing, the shame that you succumb to such a juvenile and such a cheesy, low vices that you call jealousy, that you succumb to it. You can't control it. It overwhelms you. You let it overwhelm you. And then the feeling of 그 굴욕이죠, 굴욕. How could I be overwhelming by such a stupid little emotion called jealousy? But it does. Doesn't just have to do with man and woman. It deals with like how much education, how much money, how much successful. You can see this in a lot of ummas, right? A lot of moms when it comes to around like college entrance time. Some moms send their kids to UCLA, but some moms have to put up with their sons and daughters going to non-UCs. Do you understand the jealousy in that circle? The dad, same thing. Your dad's making, what, $30,000 a year, and that dad makes $300,000 a year. Someone drives a Maserati into a church parking lot. Wow. And then there's some guy who's driving in, I don't know, Toyota or Hyundai, Sonata. Sonata라고 우리 맨날 놀았는데, Sonata라고. Sonata. Anyway. So there's a lot of thing called like this jealousy thing among human beings. And why is God equating himself with that word? Jealousy never really has anything positive in terms of like human society. And God brings it up because people hurt each other with this jealous emotion. But God says, I love you, and I am jealous for you, for your faith, for your life, not to be spent on these idols. And God shamelessly says it, right? 사랑은 좀 당당한 거예요. You know how tough it is to say, I'm jealous? You think it, but you actually say that to someone else. It's very degrading. It's very degrading, right? You don't say, you'd rather leave than actually say, I'm jealous of you doing that to someone else, whereas you're supposed to do that for me. You know how degrading that is? Yet God does that for our love. We need to look at it in this context. What does the idol offer that will benefit us? And who knows what that will turn out to be better than God himself? We think we know what we are getting into. After all, Israelites started because of the covenant. And here are the Israelites trying to make that new covenant with the idols, which is nothing, a creature, creation, right? Stones, suns, squirrels. I don't know if they worship squirrels, but they worship animals, tigers, lions, whatever. Creatures, creation, instead of the creator. And from a creator's perspective, you know what they're heading into. Nothing. Death waiting for them. This is not going to help them. Whereas God gives them a covenant, a relationship, which is very undeserving of us. God goes out of his way. That's the difference. In the book of Ezekiel, I'm just going to summarize this for you. We don't need to go into the whole chapter of Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 8 talks about Ezekiel having a vision. God pulls him by the hair in his vision and then takes him around. Now, the book of Ezekiel was written when Israelites lost their country and they were under captivity, so they don't have a country. Okay? These are captives, like slaves. Okay? They don't have a country. They're treated like really like dogs almost. They're servants. And they think about how come Israel was devastated? How come Israel was destroyed? And then God is telling Ezekiel, the prophet of that time, to tell these captives these things that God saw. Ezekiel chapter 8, verse 1 through 6, God takes Ezekiel and shows him the idol that existed within the city of Jerusalem around the north gate. Verse 7 to 13, God takes Ezekiel and shows him the secret room inside the temple that the leaders of Israelite made to secretly worship the idols. Verse 14 and 15, we see women of Israelite mourning, being concerned about the idols. Verse 16 to 18, we see the 25 elders of Israel turning their back on God and worshiping the sun. To the captives, God is laying it down one by one. There are four things that God is saying, I am jealous. When you do these type of things, when we mistake the source of life and livelihood, when Israelites were having these idols in that city of God, Jerusalem, why did they do that? What does the idol offer that these Israelites were so entertained by the idol worshiping? Some of the commentators say that the idol that God showed Ezekiel was a god of fertility. You know, back then, having a lot of kids is power. The more free labor, like Teacher Pat used to say, oh, I love free labor in church and, you know, we work. So back then, the more kids you have, the more labor, the more source of money you can bring in, right? The more chores, you don't have to do it. Hey, vacuum, clean up, like clean the bathroom. The more kids you have, you can do a lot of these things. So fertility meant something else, right? And if you have like 10 kids in your family and they all grow up, no other family can actually attack you or take stuff away from you. So fertility is important back then. So they were bringing in these idols that are supposed to give you fertility. They don't know if they actually do, but they were leaning toward that. Now what's the problem with that? Aren't you supposed to believe in God because you have a covenant? All your needs, all your life's vision, all your life belongs to him. Your life is His. God blesses you. God nurtures you. God provides for you. God protects you. But then you want more. So you still go on the side note, then you try to bring in, like, try to complement, right? Trying to feel what you think you're missing. So what are you saying in turn? God, you're not perfect for me. I need more. We do that still. Believing in God is not enough for us. We need six-figure income. We need a house. I need a degree from university or higher education. I need a good look. I need my six packs. I need my beautiful face, slim figure, bikini bod, you say. I need all those. If you're trying to seek anything outside Christ as a source of life and livelihood, you will seek idols. What about your pleasure? You want to seek it outside God? That's why you go into like cocaine, you know, people smoking pot out there, people having affairs outside marriage. I know a lot of ajashis around my age, they still want to go to clubs and norebangs and call women. It's not entirely uncommon, even in this day and age. Is that shocking? No, it happens. It's reality. I call that reality. I see them all the time. Some of them are called elders and deacons. You want to seek something outside God as a source of your livelihood and your life, basic necessities of your life? That's the idol that stands between you and God, and you will not have a normal relationship. Just replace God with your loved one. See how they feel. How would you like it if your mom and dad go out and have an affair and you know about this? How would you feel if you have found another love of your life after you get married? The Bridges of Madison County, isn't it? The beautiful Pulitzer Prize winning book. Yeah. That's the media that we surround ourselves with. And we just aimlessly just kind of suck it all in. That's the world we live in. You must discern. You must filter. You must purposefully stay away from some of the Netflix stuff. Some of the free video stuff, YouTube, oh, wow, YouTube, oh, amazing. All the contents that are there that leads you away from God, amazing. If that means you have to fast Facebook, would you, like, have that withdrawal and start shaking hands? Oh, I need to do my Facebook, Instagram. See, I don't do any social network I just don't have time. But some of you do it. Very few of you do it the right way. You know, once I had a privilege of interviewing this professor, Korean professor from UCLA. He was electrical engineering. He used to work with the Google founder, whatever his name, Sergey Gurin or whatever. They used to work together when Google was just a search engine. And then, you know, one comment that he said about social network, because Google was trying to do it and Facebook was already very much a big hit back then. He says, you know, they say, a lot of scientists, engineers say it's a brain dump. And I do agree. Some of the people who attended our church and left, I see so much of their drunken pictures. Our sister sitting in a drunken man's lap, all faces all flushed up. They're drinking booze, half naked. So I said, no, you know what? I just don't want this. I walked away from Facebook. Some people, yeah, you can do it. Maybe you guys are having a surveillance over some people. I don't know. I don't want to do that. But it shows where you're drawing all these joy and fun out of. You don't equate God with fun and joy, do you? For me, I do. I think in worship so much fun. You know, there are different speakers at church. I see good people. Your group, when you guys have fellowship, I love it. I think you should have more fun this way. Good, clean fun. And then when it's not a fun time, that you guys can comfort and encourage one another. As a community of God. Not a community of a secular body. That's something else. Second part, verses 7 to 13, when the leaders were worshiping in the temple of God, idols, right? See, it's a hidden secret room. Do you have hidden stuff in your life? Skeletons in your closet? The favorite song of mine from Eminem, I'm Sorry Mama. I was like, I have skeletons in my closet or something like that. I think we all have skeletons in our closet, right? And you see that in a lot of politicians when they go through hearing to see if they're fit, you know, Donald Trump and everybody else. Everybody has a skeleton in their closet. Hillary Clinton, Democrat, Republican, Green Party, Bernie Sanders, everybody. We all have skeletons in our closet. But what do you do in that closet space? What do you do in your hidden room when you're all alone, when you're driving all alone, when you're in the bathroom all alone, when you're in the house all alone? What do you do? What do you think? What are you worshiping? What are you enticing? What are you going after? What do you seek on your browser? Why do you clean out your browser history? Is there something you need to hide? I've done it. We all have done it. And God says, that's a way that we are attracted to these idols. See, idols are very attractive. Look at K-pop. All these little boys with makeups and all these little girls and teenage girls dressing that way. I just don't want my daughter to see something like that. Like, you know, I'm sorry, I'm a social science major, and we learn about this in communications, like how advertising and media is trying to exploit the little young girls and boys so they can make more money. It's capitalism, more of consumerism, to consume more. And look where it's leading, is everything's sexual, and it's getting younger and younger. And you need to be able to see that, to have a proper context of all this media, all these music videos and all these songs. I can't even hear the song on the Billboard these days because my son loves music. I told him, you know, don't download Billboard music. Some K-pop I'm okay with, but it's downright too sexual, downright degrading other human being. It's downright like boasting of self, like Hose Jin in Korea, right? Like, I am so good, I'm so good looking, I'm so powerful, you're nothing. You know those kind of things? How stupid can you get? And what are we feeding our kids with that kind of media? What are you feeding yourself with, thinking it's okay? It's not okay. There's a germ that affects everybody, and that's those kind of germs. You have a hidden, secret place in your heart, or some place, actual place, that where you engage yourself in an idol presence, something that entices you, and you know it doesn't, that God won't approve. God says, I'm a jealous God. I'm a jealous. I'm not allowing this to happen in your life, to your face. Verses 14 and 15, God is jealous when we show more concern for the idols than we do for God. They were mourning for the idols because they couldn't get what they want. What really upsets you? What devastates you? If you fail a test, does that like, oh, it's the end of life? My son's been playing Overwatch. And he didn't come down when we call him for dinner, so I said, you're not playing Overwatch today. And then he was like, oh, grim. It's like life was sucked out of that guy. Right? Well, he's very dramatic, kind of like me. Like, you get dramatically passive. And when he's happy, it's like, ah. It's like, it's really funny. It's like seeing him, and I see myself like in a very raw version. And I'm thinking, maybe I was like that when I was in junior high. And then I, God, you know, God, you had mercy on me, and I'm glad I'm not doing that now. You guys will look back on your life when you're around my age or a little bit older, and you'll see, wow, you know, I've been such very draining presence for the people around me. And then you start appreciating your mom and dad for putting up with you. But that's the course of life. So, you know, when we show more concerns for idols, concerns for something that really devastates you or something that really makes you happy. You bought a house and like, oh, my dream's achieved. Look, you know how long that lasts? 3 years. You've been married, honeymooner. You think your love is going to last forever? Just look at your mom and dad now. That doesn't last because we're sinners. We cannot maintain that pure, unconditional, giving love like that. When you first have kids, oh, I'm going to, like, you know, make him into man of God, women of God. They all say, like, when they pray, they have, like, tears. And it's like, ugh! About 2-3 months down the road, sleepless nights, like, they wake up at 3 a.m. You have to give him, like, milk and change their diaper, and it's so stinky, and you're tired, you're beyond your mind. You say that again. We're very fickle. What excites us? What makes us sad? What makes us extremely giddy and happy? Think about that. Is God the reason? Most cases, it's something else. It's your grades, getting a new car, or getting a car accident, maybe having a flu that devastates you, having a pimple when you have a date. Ooh, yeah. Or you're not able to lose weight. Like, you know, I've been having this gut for 20 years now. After I got married, I gained 20 pounds. It's all concentrated in the midsection and behind, and it's not going anywhere. But you have to live with that. This is my friend. And this is my friend. I live with these good friends, but my wife doesn't think so. Some things that you can't handle, but, you know, what devastates you? What really makes you upset? Think about that. Not doing quiet time, not being able to really feel the presence of God, not being able to worship in such a joyous way, does that really disturb you, upset your day? When you do QT, it's like, I still don't get it. I don't know what you're telling me, Lord. And it disturbs you throughout the day. Have you ever had that experience? For me, once in a while, a few times a year. But other than that, I'm like, it's one of those days. God says, I am jealous for your excitement. I am jealous to be the sole love of your life. Ezekiel 8:16 to 13, he talks about God is jealous when we turn our backs on him. Do you turn your back on God when you call yourself a leader? When do you turn your back on God? Friends, girls and boys we love, they don't believe in God. But you gotta have that person. You gotta have that car. You gotta have that job. So you do whatever it takes. The end justifies the means. Darwinism, ain't it? The strong survive. Somehow we bought that message. And we think it's completely separate from what God says. No. God set up a covenant between you and I. So when we try to set up another compromising contract, covenant, promise with the idols. Because you know what idol is? It's give and take, right? It's give and take. Why do you go to the idols for give and take? Because you want something that God is not giving it to you. You want that beautiful woman. You want that beautiful man. You want that beautiful six-figure salary and nice fringe benefit job. You want that house. You want beautiful kids. You want health for you, your family. But God's not giving it to you, so you go to the idols. That's idol worshiping. You're not willing to wait. for God. When Abraham was promised a son, he had to wait till he's like almost 100. That's why Sarah laughed at it, right? Do you wait, trusting in God? Maybe you don't get what you prayed for right away, but maybe God is giving you something better, just because you may not be ready for what's coming. Do you have that trust in God? Even if he doesn't give it to me now, maybe he doesn't give it to me now, maybe he hits me now, maybe he makes me fail now, but I believe God has a better plan than me. Do you believe in that? Then I think our behavior, the course of our life, will be very, very different than what it is now. And that's faith. What kind of faith do you have? What kind of faith do I have? God says, do not set up a covenant with somebody else. Exodus 25, right? Do not worship idols. Don't go snooping around just because you don't get it from me. I have better plan for you. What does the idol offer? False promise? Cheat and fraud. It's like voice phishing, isn't it? Oh, you just won $500,000 in your bank account, but you need to call me and give me a social security number. You bought into it. Idol worshiping is like voice phishing, cheating, fraud. They'll do whatever they can. And they're very sophisticated. It's very enticing. You know, one time I got an email from Ray-Ban, the sunglass maker. And Ray-Ban, you know, I've been looking at this. And I have one, but I wanted another one. It's like around $79, $89. And I got this email that looks like it's from Ray-Ban. All the pictures are just the same, all the product. But it says half price off. $49 for Ray-Ban. Wow. So without thinking twice, normally I kind of look through the website, I look at their email and everything else, I Google it to see who is it from, but I don't know why, I don't know what came over me, but I actually put in my credit card number and actually did it. And then I got an email confirmation from China, Shandong. Like, what? Ray-Ban's in China? So I kept on looking it up, and it's like, they have nothing to do with Ray-Ban. So I contact whoever emailed me, say, hey, you're not Ray-Ban. Give me my money back. I said, well, you know, there's a 20% return charge even if you don't buy. You sure? We'll still send you the product. I said, no. Send it to me, and then I call the credit card to make sure that they don't charge anymore. We behave that way. We easily buy into this. I think important thing is that you have to keep yourself alert from all these temptations. I mean, what joy can the idols give you? At what cost? Is it that important that you turn your back against God and then go for whatever that pleases you at that moment? You want to get something now for your pleasure now, for that satisfaction, instant gratification now, and then just completely trample the relationship, trust you have with God for that thing? You want to have sex now instead of waiting until you're married for that pleasure? All the movies and TVs that you see show that's the way to go. Really? You want to cheat just a little bit so you can make quick $1,000? Shoplift? All these temptations are surrounding us, right? At your work, at your school place, from your friends, from your peers. God says, I am jealous. Don't do that. Life without God leads to death. It leads to death. And you're putting yourself back into that prison. And you're not going to be free. So what God is saying, I am a jealous God. Do not betray me. Again, have you ever said, I am jealous. I am jealous for you. Have you ever said that out of your mouth, actually? I'm sure you thought of it. But have you ever felt so desperate? I am jealous. Have you ever said that? knowing all the connotation what this jealous means, you know, man don't feel like, you know, I'm man-like when I'm saying I'm jealous. And the women, when you say you're jealous, you feel like you're selling out. You feel like you're degrading yourself way below. No. God is saying here, for your love, so that you will not end up under death again, the power of death, authority of death, and the punishment of death, I am jealous for you. Come. You don't belong here. Come with me. Do not betray me. I know I have the life. I gave you life. You're messing it up. Don't go there. Do you hear the plea from God? You know how much he has to degrade himself from God above, the creator God, to come down to that level and say that I am jealous for you? 눈높이를 맞추는 거잖아요. He's like super PhD level and now he has to come down to a little baby level and say, I'm jealous. Come. I do not want you to follow that, follow this. For I am jealous for you. I love you. I think this is so hurtful for God. He doesn't say it. And he says, yes, I grieve. God does show his emotions. You know, being perfect does not mean he hides his emotion. We think of perfection as a mechanical definition. That's human error. God is the definition of perfection. He shows emotions. He shows justice. He shows mercy. Sometimes he relents so that we will not be punished. That's the only case he relents, so that we will not be punished, to show mercy. That's the idea of perfection, not the mechanical engineering definition as we have it. Don't put God in your box. God is perfect because he shows emotion. He says, I am jealous. I am loving. I love you. I don't want you to go wrong. Don't go there. Don't do this. Come back unto me. Don't worship idols. I am the source of all life. I have life right here. I'm your lifeline. Come back unto me. That is God's plea. It's incomparable. Some of the theologians actually say, when God says, I am jealous, he's saying, I am loving, I am passionately loving you, I am enthusiastic in what I'm trying to do for you, and I have this great fervor for you. Do you understand and do you see the passion of God putting himself down to the level of saying, I am jealous for you, so we can finally understand his love for us? He gave to the level of sending his son to die. You know, we were doing QT on Book of Numbers. Book of Numbers, chapter 4. That was something surprising. I think that was QT like last week. And I was asking my children to do QT on this, and they talk about women having an affair outside the marriage, and they have to take her to the priest. And like, how do I explain this? You know, I don't want to say, oh, you know, when mommy has an affair and we have to take him to the priest. I didn't want to explain it that way. But one thing that actually really caught me by surprise, and there was a first mention of the word amen. You know how amen came out to be? When the women did something wrong, you know, and then she does go through whatever procedure that she needs to go through and then show herself to the priest. And the priest says, if you are not telling the truth, you will be punished and you will be cursed. And then that's the moment when she has to say amen to the curse. It's not amen to the blessings. It's saying, so be it to the curse. There's a difference. You do this, you're going to be cursed. So be it. That's different. Then if you follow God, if you obey God, you're going to have whatever you wish when you pray. Amen. That's very different. It takes so much more for you to process, doesn't it? Kevin, if you marry outside your marriage, you have an affair, and you're going to be cursed. And Kevin says, amen. That's the man. You do something wrong. If you do something wrong and you are cursed, and Yuha says, you know, God, so be it. Amen. That's how amen was used in Book of Numbers. and Deuteronomy multiple times. When you say amen, be careful, guys. Make sure you stand behind what you're saying. God says, I don't care about my level of my God level. I don't care if I could save you. I am jealous for you. Choose me, for that is the only way of life. For those stubborn people, lazy people, and foolish people, God himself brought his level down to saying, I am jealous. It's like a strong man treating the weak ones as if he is weak. You constantly met these people who are really trampling all over the weak people. And to the strong, they're like subservient. They act like slaves. God's not that way. If you think you're prideful, you think you've got all that, and God comes on strong. But if you're weak, God comes to you in a gentle breeze, and he whispers to you, I am with you. I'm a merciful God. I'm a generous God. Please get that through our heads. God is love. Do not leave that love. There's nothing better out there for you. That's what God is saying. And if you happen to entertain the thought, God is saying, I'm a jealous God. I'm very passionate about your life. It's about you. It's not about God losing something. But it's about you falling into the wrong hands. Falling into the wrong lifestyle. Falling into a wrong philosophy. I don't want that, God is saying. I am jealous for you. The jealousy of God will lead us to be holy. Let God's wrath and anger be our wrath and anger. May the idol worshiping in your life become a stench. A stinking presence in your life. That you will hate what God hates. And you will love what God loves. I want you to accept the love of God that he calls jealous love into your life. And accept it, embrace it. And may that be the source of everything that you got to overcome the unbearable, impossible situation that you maybe have faced or you may be facing millions of times for the rest of your life. I can promise you there's thousands and millions of troubles that are just kind of waiting to happen in this life. But God does not shelter you from it so you can become a bubble boy. No. God helps you to grow immunity so you can overcome the filthy world that we live. And that's the life the Christians will live. I want all of you to appreciate and love and thank God for his jealousy, for his love. And I want you to love the same way. Let us pray. Dear God, I'm not holy as I want it to be. I'm not so forgiving as I want myself to be. But I do want to pursue you. As close as I can get, I want to pursue you so that I can attain to the fullness of the measure of Christ. Not to boast, not for satisfaction reasons, but just because I know that's the only way for me to live, to have this life, to have it to the full. Life living in the green pasture in the still waters. For where you are with me, if you're with me wherever I go, whatever situation I'm in, it's heaven there. For you will be my shepherd, and you care for me with great love you call jealousy. Father, help me and my friends here, my brothers and sisters here, not to misunderstand when you say, I am a jealous God. That it is one of your attributes that you reveal to us to communicate to us how enthusiastic and how passionate you are about your love for us. May we just be thankful, thankful and thankful for your love. And may that love satisfy us. May that love make us feel content. May that love makes us into forceful warrior that we can overcome the unbearable and the impossible in our life. We thank you for being who you are. Thank you for this amazing love. And may we have the full grasp of how amazing you are in this coming week. May you bless my Cornerstone brothers and sisters and everyone who's worshiping here. May your spirit be truthful and give them wisdom and discernment this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's come before the Lord in prayer. And just as we've heard from Teacher Sam, the word of the Lord, I think it's very relative to each and every one of us. So let's respond to God in prayer and truly lay down anything that we may be placing before him, down before him, that he may be our ultimate desire as we heed his call. So let's take this time and respond to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray.
Father God, Lord, I pray as we go on to this week that we may never forget what you have done in our lives, Lord, that we may not put you in a box or put you on the sides, but we may always keep you in our lives, Lord, the center of our hearts. As I pray for this offering, Lord, I pray that it may be used for your kingdom, and that whatever we have to give up to you through our tithes, through our serving, that it may be used for your glory and your glory alone.
It's all right. We'll end the song.
take us back, the place we began, the simple pursuit. Nothing but you, the innocence of heart in your hands. God, take us back. God, take us back to an unswerving faith in the power of your name. Heart beating for a kingdom to reign, a church that is known for your presence again. God, take us back. Nothing and no one comes close to you. Nothing could ever come. That is known for your presence again. God, take us back, because nothing and no one comes close to you. Nothing could ever come close. Nothing and no one, it's you and you only. Nothing could ever come close. Nothing and no one comes close to you. Nothing could ever come close. Nothing and no one, it's you and you only. Nothing could ever come close. Again, God, take us back.
Nothing and no one comes close to you. Nothing could ever come close. Nothing and no one, it's you and you. Nothing could ever.
Let's end in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
For your presence to fill up my senses. There's a yearning again, a thirst for discipline, a hunger for things that are deep.